Okay, so welcome back. It was our pleasure to continue the Nuremberg lectures in geometric analysis. Professor Misha Bialy from Tel Aviv University will continue his series of talks. His second talk is called Integrable Billiards and Rigidity 2. Misha, please.
Okay, thanks a lot for the introduction. So let me remind first what we did last time. We are concerned with Birkhoff billiard in the plane, that is, line is getting reflected through the boundary, and so you get another line and so on. And we are discussing the so-called Birkhoff conjecture, asking if the only integrable billiards are ellipses. And so integrable must be understood in could be understood in several ways. And our approach with Mironov is based on the so-called Hopf type rigidity. And theorem which I want to discuss first is this. It was theorem two last lecture, of the last lecture. So let gamma be a C2 smooth, centrally symmetric, simple closed curve, and the essential condition of positive curvature. Suppose that billiard ball map T has a continuous rotational meaning going around the cylinder, invariant curve alpha, such that alpha is of rotation number 1-4 and consists of 4 periodic orbits. All orbits are 4 periodic. And here it is drawn on the face cylinder, this curve alpha, and let us denote a script, the region between alpha and the boundary, and suppose that this region is foliated everywhere by curves which are invariant under the billiard ball map T. So you pick point here, the image lies again here, and so on. So if this happens, then gamma is an ellipse. So foliation by curves is one of the options to understand integrability, because if you have an integral that is conserved quantity, levels of this integral, they give invariant curves. And second statement is that the same conclusion you can formulate in variational terms. So if all orbits in A are locally maximizing, this is analogous to geodesics to be local minima, and here it's maxima, then gamma is an ellipse. So a second, in fact, is more general statement than one, because we saw last lecture that if you have a continuous rotational invariant curve, then necessarily all orbits lying on these curves, on this curve, are locally maximizing. Therefore, statement two, in fact, implies one. And this we saw last lecture. Okay, so now I want to prove, in fact, the statement two, or sketch, at least sketch the proof. So, we understood last time that on the space of oriented lines, one can introduce symplectic coordinates in two ways. And one is standard, known to Birkhoff, and generating function was called L, the length of the chord. And the second way to introduce symplectic coordinates on the space of lines, they are called P phi. This is, here it is drawn. So phi is the angle of the right normal to this line, and P is sine distance to this line. So two coordinates. In fact, the symplectic form reads dp d phi in these coordinates. And we understood last time that with respect to these coordinates, there is a generating function which I call non-standard one, s of phi phi one, and it is written in this form twice h psi sinus delta, where psi is half average of phi phi 1 and delta is a half difference, and h here is support function, n is norm, cosine psi, the psi is normal in this direction to the boundary. Okay, so now last time there was a question. Igor asked me, and I tried to draw, and it was impossible. So the question was, what is this S geometrically? And here is the picture. Suppose I have a line in the direction phi, a line reflected in the direction phi 1, then this S, which was discussed above, is just the sum of two lenses, PR and RQ. So this sum here, OP and OQ, are perpendiculars to the lines L and L1. So if you have a periodic orbit, for example, then if you sum this S all together, you get usual perimeter. So this is action. Well, we know action is invariant, but S has several advantages. For example, as we shall see, S is very easy to differentiate. Here it is. It's any derivative you can compute immediately, unlike L. So this is one of the advantages. Okay, so let me continue. Igor, it's okay? So now let me remind what we did last lecture. So if we have a rotational invariant curve, then all orbits, as I said, are locally maximizing. And this means that the criterion which I formulated last time, this means that there exists a positive Jacobi field along every orbit. And let us normalize this discrete Jacobi field. Let us normalize with delta phi 0 equals 1. And then with the help of this Jacobi field, one can construct, that's what we did last time, we constructed a function omega such that it maps our region A script real function, and at the point P0 phi 0, it's just the ratio delta P0 delta phi 0, where delta phi is this our Jacobi field. And delta P is in direction of P, how it varies in direction of P. So this omega is exactly analogous to a function which Hopf used in the Riemannian case. And we understood last time how this function evolves under the mapping. So if we have P0, phi 0, a point, any point on A, in A script, and P1, phi 1, its image, then the following, this equations hold. This is the evolution of function omega. And now here's crucial thing for the proof. We choose a function A and B, B which is just composition A with a billiard ball map. So we have say A computes in a point and B computes in the next point, the same quantity, and let us call them weights, because what I am doing now, I want to multiply the first equation by B square and the second equation by A square and subtract. Okay, then I get the following, that this difference equals A square S11 plus b square s22 plus s12, where in the bracket I will get this expression, where you see I have this Jacobi field inverse times b square, and here delta phi 1 times a square. Very good. So now remember that our twist condition says that this cross derivative is positive. That's what we shall see in a minute again. I don't remember if we computed this last time. So S12 is a positive number, and delta phi 1 is our Jacobi field, which was positive always. And so we have that here in the brackets. I can use arithmetic geometric mean inequality, which says that in fact this thing can be, I can write inequality instead of identity, that this is greater than equal than twice AB and S12, and the since here and here are reciprocal things. So when we multiply them, that's what I get. Okay, so now we also know that the function omega, which we constructed, is bounded because I explained last time that there are bounds on omega, and therefore one can easily see that one can estimate this by some constant. And so this is a bounded function on A. And also it is measurable, in fact. And so this, so finally, I can integrate this inequality with respect to invariant measure. What is invariant measure? It's just Liouville measure dp d phi, because our map is symplectic. And if I want, for me, it will be convenient to write it as, instead of p, to write next phi. So I have d phi zero, it's the same. And so S12 d phi zero d phi one, this is the invariant measure. So what happens when I integrate this inequality? You see, measure is preserved by t. Therefore, integral of the left-hand side vanish because measure is preserved, and here I compute quantity shifted by t, at the point shifted by t. So, I for any choice A and B as above, any choice of weights, I get the following inequality, integral of this thing, in brackets, then this measure is written here, and this must be non-positive, okay? So this is true for any choice of A and B. So my assumption that Billiard is integrable gives a lot of inequalities, okay? But mm-hmm. we need somehow to confine, and so in fact I will explain that the correct way of choosing weights is the following. So let's choose A to be momenta p0, okay, and then B is p1. So in other words, here I'm multiply here I shall substitute p0 square, p1 square, and so on, and I get a very particular inequality for this part, for this very precise choice of weights. Okay, now let me explain why this choice of weights is correct one. And this mm-hmm. Here is the reason. So you see, if I have an invariant curve for ellipse, not for ellipse, just suppose I have a foliation by level set of a function f, and I want to compute and I have a mapping which preserves this foliation, then it is very general fact that on each leaf of this foliation there is a measure which is preserved by the map. So again, I have a foliation by f equals constant, and suppose this foliation is preserved by the map, then on each leaf there is an invariant measure, and this measure is called by some people it's called Gelfand-Leré. Say Arnold calls Gelfand-Leré form, and by Arnold principle, this means that not Gelfand nor Leré invented this thing. Okay, so anyway, it's let's say Gelfand-Leré form. What is it? So I need to write this the condition that differential of f wedge this rho phi d phi must be my symplectic form dp d phi, and therefore If I do this calculation, I immediately obtain that rho of phi must be 1 over fp. So where p is fp is derivative with respect to p. So this is very general fact, what is called Gelfand-Léré form. Now we have for ellipse, we know that for ellipse we have an integral. This I showed you last time, that Berry explained to us very well, that integral in this coordinates phi p must be of this form, p square minus c square cosinus square phi. And therefore fp I can easily compute is just p. And therefore rho of phi is 1 over p. Okay? And so now now I know what is the invariant measure. It's 1 over p d phi. This means that if I write 1 over p0 d phi 0, this must be the same as 1 over p1 d phi 1. This is for ellipse. So in other words, for ellipse, I know since delta phi 0 is 1, I know that delta phi 1 is p1 over p0. And now let's come back to this. This is exactly the equality case in geometric arithmetic mean inequality. When I have equality in arithmetic geometric mean, when these two summons are equal, and this gives exactly that delta phi one equals b over a, and b over a are exactly p1 over p0, because I have chosen them like this. Okay, this explains, this easy observation explains why shall I take weights like in this form and not other. Okay, and that's what we did with Mironov. We took these weights and we computed this integral. So you see, the advantage of this generating function S is that it's very easily computable. So next slide shows here are the computations. So you see, this is first derivative, second derivative, the second S22, S12. By the way, here it is S12. If you compute, you get this expression, 1/2 second derivative plus h. This, if you look at this, this is called curvature radius of our curve in terms of support function. It's very well known. So from here, you see that this is positive. So this is twist condition, which we discussed. And here are p0, p1, which again, I can compute easily. And invariant measure, I told you S12 d phi 0 d phi 1, so it's in this form. So everything is computed, and therefore I need to plug into the integral, that's what I get. So you see, it's awful, already awful equation, inequality. So it involves my function h and delta. So and integration is deep psi d delta. Okay, now let us discuss where delta varies. So you see, delta is the angle of the line, incidence length, angle of the line. So let me go back to the picture of the domain A, and then here it is. So our lines correspond to delta varying from the graph of alpha to the boundary. At the boundary, delta equals zero, and alpha, well, we don't know the angular function of alpha. Let's denote it d of psi. So in other words, I come back to this slide. So in this integral, look, I can perform integration by delta. And delta varies from zero to some function d of psi, which angular function of this invariant curve alpha. Let me explain. Oh, here it is written. So my domain script A looks as follows. So psi delta, it pairs psi delta such that psi, it's angular variable, delta varies from zero to d of psi. And d of psi is the angular function of the of this in particular invariant curve alpha of four periodic orbits. And so I can perform the integration. And I end with the following inequality, which is some crocodile u, which is here. You see u, well, you compute is the following function. And look, there are two functions in this u. This is my support function h, and this d of psi. This d of psi is angular function of this particular curve alpha. But it turns out, so far it was very general and never required any assumption on alpha and just any invariant curve. No central symmetry assumption, but now comes in the play our assumptions. So in fact, you see this u depends on two functions, h and d, and this is a problem because I don't know how to estimate this thing because, well, they are quite unrelated and not clear how. But in our case, I shall explain in a minute that H and D are related in a very simple way. Here is this way. H, in fact, is some positive constant R, I shall explain what it is, times sinus. And then if I plug all this here, I will get another crocodile, even more frightening than the first one, because, well, I will not show you how it looks like. But it will be a function, some function u, which involves function d, d prime, and d double prime. Okay, double prime, because here are second derivatives and so on. So it's a very awful expression. And we first understood with Mironov by computer experiment. So we computed, we took several curves near ellipse, and we saw that, in fact, such an integral is not negative, but positive. And so this already showed to us that one can try to prove that it is positive. And indeed, we found, this is the lemma, which says that integral of this thing is, in fact, very simple equation, very simple expression of another function, which is cosine twice d of psi of this form. You see, mu second derivative square minus mu prime square, and factor four. But factor four is okay because I am integrating from zero to pi and not to two pi. And so, but if it were not four, but one, we recognize here Wirtinger inequality. And indeed, this lemma, which I am not proving, it's a kind of awful computation, shows that in fact, integral of u, which is the integral here, it's positive or zero. So it's not negative. And moreover, Wirtinger inequality claims that it can be zero only in one case, when mu is in fact a combination of harmonics, cosine to psi and sinus and sine psi and maybe constant. Why two psi? And because, as I said, the period is not two pi but pi. Okay, and so this already gives you the we worked first with the inequalities, and now we got equality. And if we analyze this equality, this leads here, I'm saying not hard to understand, that gamma is an ellipse. So this is the logic of this rigidity result. So first, from general ideas of Hopf type regimes, you construct some function omega, and then we understand that this u must be less or equal than zero. And then we on the other hand, we show that Wirtinger implies that this is greater or equal than zero, therefore it must be zero, and then we know precisely when equality happens, and this gives ellipse. This is the sketch of this proof, and again, I'm not telling you what are awful computations, but okay, they are written in the paper. So this is the first part of my talk today. So this is the sketch. So you see, this is exactly a kind of adaptation of Hopf idea to the case, to the discrete case of Birghoff-Billiards. Okay, now now I want to explain what is this, why H and D are related by this way, as I explained, that if I have a curve of four periodic orbits, then H equals R sinus D. And it is, in fact, very beautiful. So let us first discuss how it's for ellipse. Suppose if you have an ellipse and you have a family of four periodic orbits in ellipse like this, what you can prove that all these orbits are parallelograms, okay? And moreover, well, here it's very classical. For example, you can consult this Kohn-Zagier proof, several proofs, in fact. Okay, so these are Billiard orbits. They are called Poncelet quadrilaterals. All of them are parallelograms. You can rotate this as a it's a family. For any point on the boundary, you can construct such a parallelogram. And moreover, what is interesting that if you consider tangents at these vertices, then this quadrilateral is rectangle. So Q0, 1, Q2, Q3 is rectangle always. And moreover, it is inscribed in a fixed circle. Okay, so not only it's not only rectangle, but also it's inscribed in a fixed circle with center O. And it turns out that this idea of ellipse, in fact, can be proven. This fact, which I explained for ellipse, in fact holds true for any centrally symmetric curve, if it has an invariant curve, rotational invariant curve of four periodic orbits. In other words, the following theorem holds true. Suppose gamma is centrally symmetric, and suppose there exists a continuous rotational invariant curve alpha in this form. So in other words, angle is a function of psi, d of psi, as in the picture. In the picture, look here. Here is d of psi. Psi is angle of the normal. The curve is parameterized by angle which normal has with fixed direction. So the normal d of psi is this angle. Okay, this is in the next point and so on. So the following claims holds true. Function d is periodic, is pi periodic, not 2 pi but pi because of central symmetry. Each quadrilateral is a parallelogram. The tangents to gamma at the vertices of this parallelogram form a rectangle. And this function d satisfies this equation, remarkable equation, okay? And the following holds true. Tangent d is can be tangent d can be computed like this or with the help of derivatives. And from here, if you multiply from here, you can easily see that h square plus h square psi plus pi 2 is a constant, which we denote by r square. This means that also for in this generality, it follows that each parallelogram tangents form a rectangle, and moreover, this rectangle is inscribed in a circle of constant radius r. Okay, so this theorem, in fact, implies immediately that h of psi you can write as r sinus d of psi, and h psi plus pi over 2 as r cosinus d of psi. And this is exactly what I used in the proof, as I explained in the computation. Okay, so effective version probably I skip, not this time. Okay, now if you have questions, it's time to ask. If yes. Not, I shall explain how this technique works for outer billiards.
So, yes, just one question.
Okay.
So, in the Hopf method, you had right integral of right hand side equals zero, so, which helped a lot.
Yes.
Could you repeat why you get zero?
Yes. In Hopf original case, you had there was omega prime, and we integrated derivative with respect to invariant measure, and this was zero. Now in our case, we have the following quantity. You have some function omega which you compute at the image of p0 phi 0, and here this the same function at p0 phi 0, okay? And now look at the weights. Here weight A you take arbitrary, but B you compute at the next point. So B is composition A and T. So in other words, here if you have this function, then this function is the same as this, but computed, composed in T. But T preserves measure. So by, I don't know, some, you can change variables, right? And you can take this part, change variables by T, T inverse or T, and this one is the same, right?
I see. Thank you.
Okay. So this is the explanation. So therefore, this is the reason why I need weights. So I take A arbitrary positive, but B must be A composed with T. Therefore, for example, here I take, in next slide, I take A to be P0, then B is P1. So the same function computed at the next point, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I see. Okay, thank you very much.
So clear, right?
Yes.
Uh-huh. Okay, so now let me, the second, so I skip things because I already understand that it's impossible to tell everything. Okay, so let me now explain what is outer billiard. Serioja will explain more about all these things, generating function and so on. But I'm just from my point of view, because I want integrable billiards. So the outer billiard map acts at the exterior of, so I pick a convex curve gamma. In my case, it will be smooth, but in fact, not necessarily convex. And I have a point and I draw tangent, I fix an orientation. I draw tangent according to this orientation, and then I get the image, which is the next point, such that the tangency happens exactly at the middle. Okay, so I take a point and then I draw TA such that the tangency is at the middle. Okay, and then these billiards, this is called outer billiard. So you have, and now you iterate, right? And you ask what happens. And in particular, you can ask about periodic orbits, you can ask about invariant curves. And so this was introduced by Bernhard Neumann, I should say, because he was German born. It was in this year, and then even earlier by Day in this year. And Jürgen Moser popularized this system in 70s as a toy model of celestial mechanics. So in other words, he asked the following questions. Are there unbounded orbits for outer billiards? So in other words, you start with a point, you iterate, and the question is, how do you know if your orbit escapes to infinity? Can it escape or not? Can it fall to the curve? And this was the interest by Jürgen Moser. So he proved, in fact, that if the curve is 30, this number of derivatives, then all orbits are bounded because KM theory works, and at infinity you have invariant curves of irrational rotation numbers. So this was the his motivation to study outer billiard, because Moser was master in KM, and so this was the case. Okay, now later this theorem was improved to five derivatives. So this means that the curve must be six. L is R minus one, where R is differentiability class of gamma. So six. And then Erman, in fact, proved that R greater than three is enough. So in other words, if you have a curve, convex curve of positive curvature, which is C3 and higher than C3, like this. In fact, three derivatives plus bounded variation, for example, or Hölder class, I don't know. So C4, definitely enough. So then there are invariant curves, KM invariant curves, and therefore unbounded orbits, there are no unbounded orbits. Later, it was proven by Rick Schwarz. He was first to construct outer billiards with unbounded orbits, and then Bassam Fayad and Dolgapiat gave an example. And what happens in between? Their examples are C0 smooth. So Dolgapiat is half circle, Schwarz kites. Okay, so it's interesting direction in dynamical systems. And my question, there was a very long standing question, in fact asked by Serezha Tabachnikov some 30 years ago, how about Birkhoff-Paritsky conjecture for this class of billiards? So in other words, the question is, are there integrable outer billiards in the plane other than ellipses? So what does it mean? Integrable, so this means that there are plenty of foliation almost everywhere by invariant curves of invariant under the map. And algebraic version of this question was studied and it was answered negatively. So this means the only ellipses. This was done by Tabachnikov and then Glutzuk-Shustin. So, I would like to approach this by my technique. So let me first explain why ellipses are integrable. You see, ellipse, this problem, which I this model of outer billiards, it's affine invariant. So if you have a curve gamma and you consider an affine transformation of this curve, if gamma was integrable, then this affine image of gamma is also. So in other words, dynamics commutes with affine group. Okay, so but for if you have ellipse, you can make it circle. For circle, everything is obviously integrable. Invariant curves are concentric circles. Therefore, for ellipse, invariant curves are concentric homothetic ellipses. Okay, so now what's the theorem? So my theorem is the following. Suppose we have a curve gamma, C2. I want to stress only C2 is needed, C2 smooth. No central symmetry assumption, just C2 smooth, simple closed curve with positive curvature. Assume that outer billiard of gamma is totally integrable, I say. What does it mean? That the phase space omega, that is the exterior, omega is exterior of gamma, is foliated by continuous rotational invariant curves. Then the claim is that gamma is an ellipse. Okay? So it's a kind of, it's not algebraic approach, but here I'm confined to this particular phase space portrait. Namely, I want that everything is foliated by continuous rotational. Rotational meaning non-contractable. So I prescribe somehow topology of phase portrait. Then gamma is an ellipse. So there are two difficulties here. First, non-compactness of the phase space. So previous approach, I want to integrate something, and here I have a non-compact phase space. I need to choose weights in such a way that integrals which I get converge. The second difficulty is affine nature of the problem. So you see, affine group is much harder than usual Euclidean group. And so affine problems usually are much harder. So let me remark that recently Barak and Bernardi established analogous rigidity results for symplectic billiards, which were introduced by Alberts and Tabachnikov. And Sergei definitely will explain what they are. Okay, so now my approach relies on non-standard generating function. So as I did in the classical Birgov case, here I want to explain to you what are generating functions for this billiard. So you see, this depends on which coordinates you choose. So usually people in all previous papers, people choose what is called in envelope coordinates. Here we are. Envelope coordinates. So what are these? You take envelope coordinates of the point M0 is two numbers, alpha and L. Alpha is the angle of this tangent, and L is this distance. Okay? If you have next point, you have another angle, alpha 1, and this leg L1. Okay? And so on. So in this coordinate, symplectic form can be written in this way, dx, dy. This is the invariant. I didn't explain this. The map T billiard, outer billiard, preserves standard area form in the plane, dx, dy. And in this form can be written like this. the L square over 2 alpha. That is, L square over 2, in fact, is a conjugate momenta to alpha, okay? And one can understand that the generating function H, let's call it H, is just the area of this curved triangle here, okay? Of this curved triangle. Okay, and this is the standard one. And I'm going to use another one. This is a kind of not convenient for my purpose. But new generating function corresponds to symplectic polar coordinates in the plane. That is, for the point M, I want to associate two numbers, P and phi, where P is R square over 2, R is a usual distance, to the origin, and phi is the polar angle, okay? And so, if these are called symplectic polar coordinates, okay? And so the question is, what is the, so now I have a map, T, it maps P0, phi0, P1, phi1, and I want to understand what is the generating function of this map with respect to these coordinates. So I need to take one form, which is P d phi, R square over 2 d phi, and we need to find a function of two variables, phi0, phi1, such that T star alpha minus alpha equals ds, that is, the first derivative is minus p0, like here, and s with respect to phi1 equals p1 r1 square over 2. So this, if you think about what is this s, you immediately understand that the so you understand that this function is the following. So suppose I have two numbers, I have two rays phi0 and phi1, okay, and such that there is an angle less than pi between them, and then I need to place a segment with the ends on these rays in such a way that the tangency point is the middle of this segment. Okay, Sergey Tabachnikov explained to me that this is the same as to take hyperbola asymptotic to these rays, such that it is tangent to the curve. This is exactly the tangency point. It's an easy exercise. Okay, so here is the formula. So here I explain that S is and S is the area of this triangle. So I need to compute the area of this triangle when I place this segment, as I explained, and you can compute here everything, but these computations are a bit awful, and I shall show you first conclusion, and then I will explain how it goes geometrically. So if you compute second cross derivative of this S, then it's strictly negative. And hence, what we learned in this case, T is called positive twist map with respect to symplectic polar coordinates. What it gives? First of all, I immediately can apply Birgov theorem. Birgov theorem tells me that if you have twist map and invariant curve, then this invariant curve is necessarily a graph. In our case, this means that all invariant curves of outer Billiard, they are in fact star-shaped, because my foliation now is by radial rays. Okay, so they intersect every radial ray at one point. So this means that invariant curve must be star-shaped. I think this fact was not known before. Okay. Moreover, as I explained, all orbits on such invariant curve are action minimizing. I'm saying minimizing and not maximizing, because now you see I have, unlike the previous case, I have different sign of cross derivative. And one can check, which I'm also not do, which I will not explain, that these two degenerating functions, H and S, which I constructed, H is standard one and this one new one, they satisfy the condition, geometric assumption of the first lecture. This was used in order to say that minimizing orbits of H and S are the same, in fact. Okay. So here is the picture why S is generating function. It's geometric explanation. So you see, I have first, I want to prove that the derivative of S with respect to phi 1 equals R1, this was P1, R1 square over 2. So how to do this? Well, okay, I make an increment to the angle phi 1 by epsilon. So now it's phi 0, phi 1 plus epsilon. And previously it was phi 0, phi 1. I want to consider differences of these triangles. One is black one, and the second one is blue. This is blue. Do you see this? It should be blue. Okay, nevertheless, so I increased one ray by angle epsilon, and I want to consider what's the difference between the areas. So what I added? I added this triangle, this triangle, and so I need to subtract this one. But these two triangles, they are approximately of the same area. Why? Because M is the middle. If you change a bit, then since this was middle, you see that this area and this area differs by O small epsilon. And therefore, these they are canceled. So you are left with only this triangle. And if you and here is angle epsilon. Therefore, the derivative is just the side square over 2. And the side square over 2 is R1 square. So it's easy. This picture explains why S is indeed generating function. Here I explained with respect to phi 1, but with the phi 0 is the same. I have 5 minutes more. Okay. So, and next, what I do, I implement the same scheme. Yes, I construct this function omega as I did in the previous case. It is measurable. It satisfies this evolution condition. Now, the only difference is now that S12 is smaller than zero. I construct positive, okay. And then I have to choose the weight, to choose the weights. And unlike the previous case, I must do it because integral, in order to converge, I have to take these weights in order to make integral converging. And in fact, exactly as I explained on the previous case, I can find what are the weights, and it appears that A must be R0 minus 2, that is 1 over R0 square, and correspondingly B is 1 over R1 square, and then what I do, I compute everything as in the previous case, and what I do, and here I need to struggle with this integral. And it turns out that this can be done because there is some change of variables which simplifies a lot. And in particular, instead of two variables, this T is like delta in the previous case. I can integrate with respect to T explicitly, and I get certain inequality, which turns out to be the converse of the so-called Bliashke-Santal inequality. What is Bliashke-Santal? I'm finishing. Bliashke-Santal inequality is the following. If you have a convex figure in the plane, or not necessarily in the plane, but let's formulate it in the plane, then the product area gamma and area d dual gamma here, okay, then this must be less or equal than pi square. And moreover, this inequality, Bliashke says that this inequality is sharp and equality happens only for ellipses. And therefore, I'm almost done because in general, I know that, the converse, so I got converse Bliashke-Santala, and therefore my figure must be ellipse. Okay, that's the end of my talk. So I demonstrated rigidity approach to usual billiard, to outer billiards, some questions, interesting question. Here they are. I was discussing alpha of rotation number 1-4 for periodic orbits. It would be interesting to relax this, of course, as well as relax central symmetry assumption. There are some attempts by Kaloshin and Ujinan, and it would be also interesting to get rigidity for outer billiards on a part of the phase space and not on the all phase space. And also it's interesting to reconsider maybe geodesic flows and Hamiltonian systems with potential, because could be that there are some other approaches. And finally, I'm not sure that this geometric assumption is really necessary. Maybe it is always satisfied for two generating function of a twist map. This seems to be not clear right now. Okay, thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Mishka. Are there any questions? So let's start questions from the room.
I have a question. I need this microphone. Okay, what would you maybe say the problem statement would be for geodesic flows for some application of these techniques?
No, I'm saying that these are questions for the future. And not for the, so what I have in mind, you ask. I have in mind that probably if you allow some symmetries for geodesic mm-hmm. flow, which I don't know what to say, then probably you can get rigidity on a part of the phase space. That's what I think. But it's really just fantasy. I mean, I have no idea if it's true or not.
And this hop result for the no conjugate points means the metric is flat on the torus. Does that fit into this discussion about geodesic flows, or it's somewhat?
No, it's a kind of question. Classical result. This classical result, there you need, Hopf needs no conjugate points everywhere. That is, you have unit tangent bundle and so you have information on the whole unit tangent on the whole phase space, and yes. This is a kind of I would like to relax. That's what I'm mm-hmm. saying.
I see. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any further questions? Okay, maybe. How about questions from Zoom? So, Alina, I think Alina has a question.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you very much. It was a very nice talk. I have a couple of questions, but very quick. So, about this outer billiards, you kind of use the affine invariance in the construction of the maps because you use area, which is invariant under SLM transformations. But,
right.
But it's no, at any point, you did not really put your billiard in a special position. You didn't use this, right, for proving?
I used only one thing, which I never explained, that in fact, Bliashke-Santala inequality, since I'm discussing gamma star, you need to specify what is the origin. And yeah. In fact, Bliashke-Santala inequality holds when not for arbitrary choice of the origin. You need to choose origin at the so-called Santala point, and then it holds. And therefore, I skipped this. So, I mean, this Bljaski-Santala inequality not always hold.
Right, but for the centrally symmetric shapes will be
then,
all the
but
time.
I am not assuming central symmetry.
Now it's any curve. Okay,
but you need, but I need to choose origin at the Santala, at the so-called Santala point.
Excellent.
In fact,
okay.
not necessarily. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, it's interesting. So it was interesting for me that, in fact, Santala inequality holds not only for this choice. For example, you can choose center of mass, what is called centroid in this convex geometry. Then with this choice, Bljaski-Santala also holds.
Okay.
But you cannot, definitely, you cannot do it arbitrarily.
Right. Okay. And a second question was, you might have said, but I missed it. What is the algebraic version of the question if there exists an integrable billiard, outer billiard? What would be the algebraic? Yeah.
Just a second. So it was a question. Are you asking about result of Sergei Tabachnikov?
Yeah.
Yes, his theorem was, he asked if there is a quantity which is polynomial in the plane. You have a plane, x y coordinates. His question was. When you have a polynomial in XY which is invariant under the billiard ball map, under the outer billiard map, he answered that this happens only when this is an ellipse. In fact, he had extra assumption there. Somehow, some algebraic curve must be smooth or whatever, and Glutsyuk, Shustin, they improved Tabachnikov's result, removing this assumption.
Is this in some sense dual to the question that Arnold asked at some point, that if you have a smooth curve and then the length of the sections near the boundaries are all polynomial?
No, I don't think so. I'm not sure. I don't think so.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Are there further questions from Zoom? Okay. I have a number of questions, but maybe I will just ask one for now and further later. So I was wondering about higher dimensional Birkhoff-Parisky conjecture. What would it be? What is something like this expected to hold?
I think, it's a very interesting question, Igor. First of all, I don't know. So I mean, it's widely open, right? So first thing to say that definitely, if you have an ellipsoid, then billiard inside ellipsoid is a completely integrable system. So you can find integrals in, so it's a Liouville-Arnold integrable. So you can find integrals in involution almost everywhere independent. And so by some general theorem, you have phase space foliated by invariant tori, Lagrangian invariant tori, right? And so you can ask, you can ask if it's the only case among all convex, quadratically convex hypersurfaces. So it's a conjecture, there is a conjecture. So probably this is the only case, but I mean, it's much harder than in the plane. Even mm-hmm. Yeah, by the way, I should say that geodesic flaws on spheres, as well as on tori, integrable geodesic flaws, even in two dimensions, not so. So it's not that completed thing. So you can classification questions are very hard usually. So you need some tools to prove that the only, say, geodesic flaw is, which is integrable, is such and such, or say Liouville flaw. Or, you are right. Birgov-Paritsky conjecture exists in high dimensions, and it would be extremely interesting to make progress.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Misha. All right, any further questions from room, from Zoom? If not,
maybe I have one yes. last question. What if I have a table in R2 and I keep the metric standard near the boundary of the table, but in the interior of the table, I start changing the metric, maybe adding some curvature. Is there still a well-defined billiards map?
Yeah.
And yeah, is it something
very
that people study?
Very good idea. So, there are some papers even, maybe not this construction, but definitely Riemannian billiards is a very interesting thing. So you have a Riemannian manifold and you have a convex domain in this Riemannian manifold, two dimensions, right? And then you move along geodesics and then reflect and so on. And this is definitely a very good idea to study. So it's a kind of combination of Riemannian case and billiard, but okay. So you are very welcome to this club, right?
I see. So it's still active studying these
yeah,
types of questions.
Yeah. By the way, Sergei Tabachnikov, he is going to give his lectures after tomorrow, right? And he will explain very many models, very many other billiard models, and interesting questions.
Hi, thank you, Misha. Thank you, Misha. Yeah.
Okay. Thanks for coming, and it was fun.